I think people can look at me. Hi. Think you can see me all right. So I think you can hear. Hope so. Can you hear? Everyone? Can you hear? Yep, if you're able to hear, then we can start the session. Okay, cool. Hi, everyone. So, what we're going to discuss in this particular session is on the urinary tract infection and its approach. That's what we're going to see. UTI and this approach. And please note that I have given a referral code here. This is my referral code, that is Dr. Dilip 10, and you can use this referral code and you can avail 10% discount on the Unacademy platform. Clear? Okay, so we are going to discuss on the UTI in this particular section. So what is the definition of UTI? So first of all, you have anatomical definitions. Let me put a little bit thinner one. So anatomical definitions are there, have clinical definitions also. So what do you mean by anatomical definitions? Anatomical definitions, you can divide in UTI into a lower urinary tract infection, or you can divide into an upper urinary tract infection. You have two types of UTIs basically. And when you call a lower urinary tract infection, whenever you are dealing with a urethritis or a cystitis, so this will be considered as a lower urinary tract infection only. So when you are going to consider it as an upper urinary tract infection, whenever you are dealing with a pyelonephritis, that is infection of the kidney, or if you are dealing with a renal abscess, renal or a perinephric abscess, because these are the terms that you will commonly encounter when you are in the clinics. That's all. I think this is the maximum volume. I've increased as much as possible. Okay. So perinephric abscess. So these are the terms that you're going to encounter very commonly in your clinical practice. Perinephric abscess. Or it could be a prostatitis. Even prostatitis is considered as an upper urinary tract infection only. Prostatitis. Remember, this prostatitis is a very important entity. So many students think this prostatitis is a lower UTI. No. Prostatitis is actually a considered as an upper urinary tract infection only. So these are the things that you have to understand in the first place. So these are the anatomical definition, that is an upper urinary tract infection and a lower urinary tract infection. And you have a lot of clinical definitions also. Clinical definitions of UTI, you have something called an uncomplicated UTI. Uncomplicated UTI. Can somebody tell you what do you mean by uncomplicated UTI and what do you mean by complicated UTI? Uncomplicated UTI means, let me write it separately. Uncomplicated and will put complicated UTI here. So what are the definitions of uncomplicated and complicated UTIs? Uncomplicated UTI means any cystitis in immunocompetent women. So which means any cystitis, which means I'm talking about a lower UTI in immunocompetent women. Immunocompetent women. So this is referred to as an uncomplicated UTI only, but the women should be immunocompetent. So in any immunocompetent women, if you have a cystitis, that's a lower urinary tract infection, that's a uncomplicated UTI. And the patient should not have any structural or neurological disease. They should not have any structural or neurological disease. Structural or neurological disease, like bladder problems, you know, like neurogenic bladder, some nothing should be there. So this is what we refer to as an uncomplicated UTI. So what do you mean by complicated UTI? Suppose if you have a cystitis, I mean not cystitis, any upper UTIs, any upper urinary tract infection in women, or any UTI doesn't mean an upper or a lower urinary tract, any UTI in men, any UTI in men, or if UTI happens in the presence of a structural disease in the kidney, like vesicoureteral reflex, or the patient is having a neurological issue, neurological disease like neurogenic bladder or any other evidence of bladder dysfunction, or if the patient is immunosuppressed and getting a urinary tract infection. So these are the three definitions of about a complicated UTI. So this is what you have to know: upper UTI in a woman, or any urinary tract infection in men. Either it could be upper or lower UTI, doesn't matter. Any UTI in a men is going to be complicated UTI only. And finally, UTI in the presence of structural disease in the urinary tract or neurological disease or in a patient who's having immunosuppression. So all this will contribute to the definition of a complicated UTI. Very, very important point. Clear? Very, very important. Complicated UTI definition, because this has been a question for long. So what do you mean by complicated UTI? Again, I'll repeat: upper UTI in women, or any UTI in men, or UTI that is happening in the presence of structural disease in the urinary tract, or in the presence of a neurological disease like neurogenic bladder, or if the patient is having immunosuppressed state. So if UTI happens in these conditions also, it will be called as a complicated UTI only. Uncomplicated UTI means it's only a lower UTI, that is cystitis in an immunocompetent woman, but not having any structural disease, structural or neurological disease, and they should be immunocompetent as well. So these are the definitions of complicated versus uncomplicated UTI. And there is another entity called asymptomatic bacteriuria. So what do you mean by asymptomatic bacteriuria? What do you mean by an asymptomatic bacteriuria? Patients will have no symptoms, which means patient will be asymptomatic, plus at the same time urine culture will be positive. Clear? Urine culture will be positive for some organism, which means culture wise they are having some organism that is grown in the urine, but they are completely asymptomatic. So this is what we refer to as an asymptomatic bacteria. By definition, urine culture should harbor at least 10 power 5 colony forming units per ml. We'll discuss that in some time. So this is what we refer to as a asymptomatic bacteria. Once we know about the asymptomatic bacteria, let us see some of the microbiological aspects. What are the pathogens that you will see? Microbiological aspects of urinary tract infection. Why it's not moving? Okay. Okay. Okay, so let us see the microbiology. Sorry for the delay. So let us see the microbiology. Asymptomatic bacteria means the patient is not having any symptoms, but urine culture will be positive. This is what we refer to as an asymptomatic bacteria. That's it. So patient will not have any symptoms, absolutely asymptomatic, but the patient is having some urine culture positivity. Some organism is growing in the urine. That's what we call an asymptomatic bacteria. So let us go on to the microbiology. Microbiology, if it's uncomplicated UTI, the most common organism is going to be supposed to be E. coli in 80% of the cases. Apart from that, you might get with Proteus, you can get Klebsiella. These are ureas producing organisms, Proteus and all. So you can get Klebsiella, or you can get Staphylococcus saprophyticus. You can get with this. So these are the usual organisms, UTI being the most common. Obviously, everyone knows that. Suppose if it's going to be a complicated UTI, the most common organism is going to be E. coli, but in only 30% of the cases, but still the most common organism, even in a complicated UTI, is E. coli. Still, it is 30% only compared to 80% in uncomplicated, but still, you have to know that. And you can get with Enterococcus. Enterococcus is also one of the leading causes, 20% of the cases. 1 in 5 patients with complicated UTI will have Enterococcus infections. Apart from that, you might get with Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Pseudomonas happens in approximately 20% of the cases again. And epidermidis. Clear? Staphylococcal epidermidis, that is CONS, is going to happen in 50% of the patients. And you can get with other gram-negative rods, other gram-negative rods in certain cases. So these are the organisms that usually seen in complicated UTI. You can see that both in uncomplicated as well as in complicated UTI, E. coli is supposed to be the most common. There is no brainer, like everyone knows that. And you have urethritis. What are the organisms that are going to be seen in urethritis? In urethritis, very commonly you're going to see chlamydia trachomatis. These are sexually transmitted diseases. So you will get chlamydia. Then you can get with Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Neisserial infections, then ureaplasma, urealyticum. So these and all are gynec-related aspects, and Trichomonas vaginalis, Mycoplasma genitalium, and even HSV. So these are the things that are going to cause urethritis. What are the things that are going to produce catheter-associated urinary tract infection? This is called a CAUTI. This is a very important terminology. This is called a CAUTI, C-A-U-T-I. That's called catheter-associated urinary tract infection. Okay, I'll try to write it bigger because the main problem is my screen size is a bit bigger. That is the main issue. My screen size is a little big, so I have to write it very big. So it's a 27-inch screen what I'm having, so that's the problem. Okay, I'll try to write it bigger. So you have a catheter-associated urinary tract infection. It's called CAUTI. Again, in a CAUTI, Candida is supposed to be the most common. Candida, that is yeast. That's what otherwise we refer to as yeast. So Candida is supposed to be the most common, approximately in 30% of the cases. Apart from that, E. coli is still here. It is prevalent in approximately 25% of the cases. And you have a lot of other organisms like other gram-negative rods. So all these things are possible. But remember, these are the most common organisms. Again, complicated UTI, E. coli, uncomplicated UTI, complicated UTI, E. coli, uncomplicated E. coli, urethritis, chlamydia trachomatis, very commonly Neisseria gonorrhoeae, and CAUTI candida, followed by E. coli. So these are the common organisms. This microbiology is not that important, maybe because we are moving on from the most common era to a, more conceptual era in the current questions, but still you might be needing to know this particular facts. Clear? So these are the microbiological aspects. So once you know this, now we can also start writing on other aspects like clinical manifestations, clinical features of a UTI. So what are going to be the clinical features? So first spectrum is cystitis. So how cystitis is going to present? Everyone knows they are going to present with dysuria, urgency, and frequency. Every girl would have experienced this cystitis, isn't it? So it usually presents with dysuria, urgency, frequency, or a hematuria with the usual suprapubic pain. So you have suprapubic pain. That's what they call it as a lower abdominal pain. Many girls would have experienced this because there is a, study data that is telling every, women in the reproductive age group at least experiences a single attack of UTI per year. Maybe known or unknown, doesn't matter. They experience at least a single attack, one attack of UTI every single year. They minimum have one attack of UTI. So it's very, very common in women. So all these things you can see, right? So usually, remember, fever is notoriously absent. So this is something really important to understand. Fever you will not get. Usually in a cystitis, you will not get a fever. Most of the time, fever will be absent. You don't get a fever because there is no fever. Do not try to rule out a urinary tract infection. Many times in a cystitis, you will never get a fever. Very, very important point. Because this is something, missed by majority of the students. Especially practicing doctors also. So they think like UTI means they should have a fever. So they may not have fever if you have a simple cystitis. Remember, whenever you have a cystitis, the most important differential diagnosis for this is urethritis and vaginitis. This also has to be ruled out. Because whenever you have a urethritis and vaginitis, why this point is important? Because these urethritis and vaginitis also can present with similar features, which means this patient is having a sexually transmitted infection. So that is why ruling out a urethritis and vaginitis in a woman who's having cystitis is really, really important, because it might give rise to a whole new horizon of sexually transmitted infection in the patient if the patient is having an associated urethritis and vaginitis. So always when you have a cystitis in a reproductive age group woman, always rule out associated urethritis and vaginitis. Clear? So how urethritis is going to present? Urethritis is going to present similar to, I mean, cystitis only. They will have similar to cystitis. Same features of cystitis will be there. Plus, patient will have a urethral discharge. Patients will have urethral discharge. Remember, if the patient is well educated, you can ask for the urethral discharge. But the patient is not educated properly, you have to strip down and examine for the urethral discharge. Especially in countries like India, especially in low socioeconomic status, this urethritis has to be ruled out for sure. So, cystitis along with urethral discharge will go towards a urethritis only. So, then how prostatitis is going to present in males? Prostatitis. So, usually prostatitis, you have two types of prostatitis. One is chronic prostatitis, which is very common in India. And you can have acute prostatitis also. Prostatitis patients, chronic prostatitis will be again presenting similar to cystitis. How your cystitis is there, similar to cystitis only they are going to present. There is no difference. But at the same time, they will be having certain additional picture, like they may have a symptoms of obstructive features. Obstructive symptoms. Like for example, typical prostate obstructive symptoms like hesitancy of micturition and weak stream, which means the stream of the urine may be very small. Weak stream, hesitancy, all these things will be there, but they come similar to cystitis only. So this is how you diagnose a prostatitis. Again, a very, very important point. And acute prostatitis will present in a completely different way. So they're going to present with perineal pain. They'll be presenting with perineal pain. They'll be coming with fever and tenderness on prostate examination. When you do a digital rectal examination, DRE, you will see prostatic tenderness. Prostate tenderness. Very, very important. So, this is how you diagnose acute prostatitis. Whatever words I'm telling you in this are the exact translations of questions in the exam. Please do understand that. So, this is how your examiner is going to ask the questions in the exam. Be very, very sure about that. So, these are the clear features of a acute prostatitis and these are the clear features of chronic prostatitis, and these are the going to be the features of urethritis, and these are the features of cystitis, which means when you can diagnose cystitis, when the patient is having urinary symptoms but no fever. Usually they don't have fever. I'm not telling all the cases. Usually they don't have fever, but there should be no urethral discharge and there should be no obstructive symptoms, or there should be no tenderness of the prostate or the problem. So, because you have to rule out other features also. If you have cystitis features with all these things, it goes towards a urethritis or a prostatitis. So, be very careful before diagnosing all this. So, how your pyelonephritis is going to present? You have another whole new differential diagnosis, pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis is a relatively serious spectrum because here the kidney is infected. Clear? So, usually pyelonephritis will have fever. Fever, there is no doubt about that because it's a systemic illness. So, because pyelonephritis often presents like a systemic illness. It's like a septic, infection. It's like a septic focus. So, definitely they will have a fever. There is no doubt about that. And along with it, they will have chills. Then you might have a flank pain or a back pain. Flank or a back pain. Along with it, they will have nausea and vomiting because of the irritation of the peritoneum. And along with it, they will have diarrhea also. I've seen a lot of cases that are presenting with a diarrhea. Many times it's been mistaken as a acute gastroenteritis, but still finally ending up with pyelonephritis. In India, the most common underlying factor for pyelonephritis is diabetes mellitus. Diabetes is very, very important. So, majority of the times, this is the most important precipitating factor. Diabetes mellitus and pyelonephritis, very, very common. Whenever a diabetic patient is coming with fever, I think about only two things. Either a pneumonia or a urinary tract infection, especially a complicated UTI like pyelonephritis. That's what I'm going to think about. Apart from that, I'm not going to think about many other things. So, this is all about pyelonephritis. These are the clinical features. And how your renal abscess is going to present. This is the final presentation I'm going to discuss. Renal abscess. Renal abscess. How renal abscess is going to present. Renal abscess, there are two types. Either it could be an intrarenal abscess or it could be a perinephric abscess. So, they'll be presenting similar to pyelonephritis only. But they will have poor response to antibiotics. That's a very important point. Poor response to antibiotics. So this is the most important entity to diagnose renal abscess. They will have poor response to antibiotics, which means the fever will persist despite starting antibiotics. Fever persisting despite starting antibiotics. So this is how renal abscess will present. They will have a similar presentation to pyelonephritis only, but they will have a poor response to antibiotics and the fever will persist despite starting the antibiotic. This is a very important AIMS question. Many times AIMS tend to ask these kind of questions only. Why they tend to ask these kind of questions? They will give probably a 60-year-old man, probably we can remember, a 60-year-old man who is a type 2 diabetes mellitus, and patient is having a fever, elevated WBC count, total count is elevated, maybe let us assume it's 20,000 per millimeter cube, and ultrasound is showing evidence of pyelonephritis, and the doctor has started on treatment with appropriate antibiotics based on the culture, based on culture of the urine, what bug is growing, based on that the doctor has started the antibiotics, but the fever is not resolving at all. So what do you suspect? What is the answer to, I mean, definitely this is going to be, I mean, this is a multiple times asked question, so the answer will be renal abscess usually, which means it's an evolved renal abscess. It could be intrarenal or it could be perinephric abscess also. So whenever you have a renal abscess like this, the only way out in a renal abscess is to aspirate this abscess. Next step is to aspirate this abscess in an ultrasound guided fashion. Ultrasound guided needle and percutaneous aspiration is indicated. You have to aspirate the abscess. Unless and until you drain this abscess, fever is not going to settle. It will be continuing only, and the sepsis will continue and the patient may die of sepsis and septic shock. So please do aspirate this abscess. It's very, very important again. Clear? Too important. So this is a very important question. That's why I think it's been asked like 3 to 4 times in the past, and I think it might be asked in the future also, considering the clinical nature of the questions in the modern era. So you have to know this particular case scenario also. So what will you suspect when you don't have a resolution from pyelonephritis and the fever is continuing despite giving appropriate antibiotics? So now the next step is going to be the diagnostic studies. What are the diagnostic studies you are going to use? Diagnostics. What are the diagnostic studies? So obviously, I'm going to do a urinalysis. First step. What are the things I'll be seeing in urinalysis? Usually they will have pyuria, increased WBCs. And apart from pyuria, they might be having bacteriuria. You can see the bacteria in the urine, but these are all non-specific. And leukocyte esterase may be positive. Leukocyte esterase may be positive. That is because of the WBCs in the urine. And nitrite may be positive. Nitrite may be positive. But please be very careful. This nitrite positive is seen only with enterobacteriaceae causing UTI. Only in them this nitrate will be positive. Remember, nitrate may be negative if it's a non-enterobacteriaceae bacteria. Suppose a non-enterobacteriaceae bacteria like Staphylococcus epidermidis, Staphylococcus aureus and all, if it's causing UTI, this nitrate will be negative only. Only it is positive if it's a enterobacteriaceae-related bacteria like E. coli, Klebsiella and all. If they cause UTI, then only you can get nitrate positivity. Very, very important point again. So these are very practical points again. Clear? Apart from that, I am going to do a urine culture as well. So I can do a urine culture sensitivity. So obviously, how we will do a urine culture sensitivity? Obviously, I'm going to do a clean catch urine. So this clean catch urine means, what do you mean by a clean catch? Either you can do a midstream urine. So this is what is preferred. Or even if you want to better do the test, you can do straight cath also. There are a lot of straight catheters available. It's not a Foley's. This, that, I mean, in local terminologies, in our hospitals, we call them as K90. I don't know how many of you are aware of this K90. It's a straight cath. So just insert, take the urine and send for culture. So straight cath is actually very good actually for taking in local conditions when you want to diagnose a urinary tract infection. Clear? So this is very important again. Straight cath. Okay. Then you can diagnose, you know, like in urine culture, what is the diagnosis? When you will make a diagnosis? Suppose in women, if it is more than or equal to 10 power 5 colony forming units per ml, or in men, if it's more than just 10 power 3 colony forming units per ml, or in catheterized patients, the patients who are catheterized, more than or equal to 10 power 3 colony forming units per ml, or in suprapubic catheter, SPC sample, suprapubic catheter sample, any amount of growth, any growth from an SPC sample is diagnostic of a UTA. Clear? So these are the standard cutoffs for diagnosing UTA. Suppose they will also ask you when you recall asymptomatic bacteria. Asymptomatic bacteria. Here the patient will be completely asymptomatic, as the name suggests, the patient will have no symptoms. But they will have a significant bacteria. Significant means if they have more than or equal to 10 power 5 colony forming units per ml of a particular organism. So this is what we refer to as asymptomatic bacteria. And again, these are the diagnostic thresholds, diagnostic cutoffs for diagnosing urinary tract infection, like females are having more than 10 power 5 colony forming units per ml, or males more than 10 power 3 colony forming units per ml, or catheterized sample containing more than 10 power 3 colony forming units per ml, or a SPC sample showing any amount of growth is going to be indicator of a urinary tract infection only. These are very, very important cutoffs. Again, very important for exams, as far as exams are concerned. Clear? So now, whenever you have a pyuria, which means patient is having WBCs in the urine, but they are having negative urinary culture, which means you are doing a urine culture sensitivity, but it is negative. What is this, term called as? This term is actually called as a sterile pyuria. This term we are going to call as sterile pyuria. Clear? So what do you think whenever you have a sterile pyuria? Whenever you have sterile, important DDs will be urethritis, number one, or it could be a nephritis of any other cause. Even it could be a glomerular cause also. Probably even a glomerular nephritis, many glomerular nephritis can produce sterile pyuria. Or it can be renal tuberculosis. Renal TB is one of the important causes for sterile pyuria. And foreign body. Foreign body is also one of the important causes. If the foreign body in the urinary tract, that is also important. For foreign body in the sense, even a simple foleys can produce a sterile pyuria. And finally, if you have some vasculitis also can produce sterile pyuria. The best example for vasculitis is Kawasaki disease. If you take Kawasaki disease and see, majority of the Kawasaki disease patients will have sterile pyuria. These are children, isn't it? So you have a lot of differential diagnosis. Nephritis, urethritis, I'm not talking about pyelonephritis, I'm talking about glomerulonephritis and other nephritis causes. Then renal tuberculosis, very important for exams, foreign body, even including a simple foleys catheter. And vasculitis, for example, you have a Kawasaki disease. These are the important exam questions. So that's why I'm listing out. So this is what we refer to as something called a sterile pyuria. Clear? Okay. Why it is coming? Okay, so this is what we refer to as a sterile pyuria. I don't know why this thing is happening. This is something new. I don't know why this particular thing is coming again and again. I don't know what to do. It's not going at all. So okay, fine. So let me finish off the topic first. So when you can do blood cultures? Sorry for that. So when you can do blood cultures? So blood cultures usually obtained only in febrile patients. Only if the fever is there, you'll obtain blood culture. Otherwise, there is no need of blood culture. Usually, the positivity of the blood culture is positive only in a patient who is having a complicated UTI. In a patient who is not having a complicated UTI and the patient is having an uncomplicated UTI, it's very unlikely to have a positive blood culture. So blood culture are only indicated in patients who are having fever. At the same time, patients who are having complicated urinary tract infections. And similarly, you have to do most common cause of sterile pyuria in our country is going to be on foreign body only. I mean, patient who's on a Foley's or patient who's on a permanent catheterization, or this is the usual cause of a sterile pyuria in our country. Clear? So it's not urethritis. This is the usual cause of sterile pyuria. That's where we encounter a sterile pyuria. Clear? Okay. Now, so when you use DNA detection techniques, DNA detection techniques can be used. Suppose if you are suspecting a chlamydia or a Neisseria. Chlamydia or a Neisseria. When you are suspecting, you can do DNA detection techniques like your cartridge-based nucleic acid amplification test. So these are the things you can do when you suspect a chlamydia. When you suspect a chlamydia or Neisseria, when the patient is having urethritis. Which means urethritis means patient should have urethral discharge. I don't think TB is such, I mean, urinary tract TB is such common in India. Foreign body is the commonest cause. I don't think TB is going to be, and that too, urinary tract tuberculosis is going to be that common in even in Indian scenario. So it's a foreign body. Take a patient with Foley's. Many patients with who's been catheterized for a long time in Foley's will have sterile pyuria for sure. So that is the idea. Okay. So prostatitis. How will you take a sample in prostatitis? When you're having a suspected prostatitis, how are you going to take a sample? Remember, prostatitis always, this is very crucial. It's first white. Morning sample, first white sample, and it should be midstream. At the same time, it should be expressed through prostatic massage. Prostatic massage. And after doing a prostatic massage, you take a urine culture. Clear? So this is how you do a you diagnose a prostatitis. So this is a very important aspect again. So this is a multiple times asked question. So this actually increases the sensitivity of urine culture, which means it increases the yield of the urine culture in this patient for prostatitis. Okay. So can you do a CT scan? CT scan is very important, especially when you are suspecting a pyelonephritis, when you are suspecting a renal abscess. Clear? Especially most important when you are suspecting a renal abscess. Very, very important. When you are suspecting renal abscess, you have to do a CT. So when you suspect renal abscess, I told you, when you are giving an empirical antibiotic, pyelonephritis, your diagnosis is pyelonephritis, you are giving antibiotics, and if there is continuing fever, even after 72 hours. Then you can diagnose renal abscess. In this condition, you have to do a CT, definitely. CT is indicated, then only you can diagnose renal abscess. Otherwise, without a CT, it's very difficult to diagnose renal abscess. So this is again a very important clinical scenario. So when you do a CT scan in a suspected urinary tract infection, only if you're suspecting a renal abscess. So when initial pyelonephritis, give antibiotics, fever not settling, do a CT, confirm it's a renal abscess. Very common. This is a scenario, this is how you diagnose. And a lot of other investigations also you can do. Suppose if you have a UTI in children, suppose if you have a recurrent UTI in children, obviously this is a prototypical question in exam. Usually this goes towards vesicoureteral reflex. If they ask you investigation of choice for a vesicoureteral reflex, your answer must be micturating cysturethrogram, MCU. So these are some special investigations that you can do. So some examples. And how will you treat the UTIs? What are the treatment of urinary tract infections? So I'll give you different scenarios. What will you do in case if the patient is having a cystitis? What will you do in case if the patient is having a cystitis? If the patient is having a cystitis, whether it's uncomplicated or it is complicated. Uncomplicated or complicated? Uncomplicated means you're going to treat with nitrofurantoin. Uncomplicated means you're going to treat with nitrofurantoin. Usually this is the standard drug I use, 100 milligram TDS for 5 days. TDS for 5 days. This is the most effective therapy actually, according to the current standards, this is the most effective therapy. Clear? Ultrasound can vaguely detect renal abscess, but it cannot confirm renal abscess, because to confirm renal abscess, you need a CT and you have to see the capsule. And sometimes you might even need a contrast CT to confirm the abscess, because abscess can be confirmed with the contrast. Biopsy in case of a glomerulonephritis vasculitis, yes, you can do a biopsy, but we are talking about a urinary tract infection and we are not talking about a glomerulonephritis and a vasculitis here. So in a UTI, there is no need for a biopsy. Why you want to do a kidney biopsy in a UTI? So glomerulonephritis and vasculitis is a completely different entity. We are not going to discuss in this current lecture. So nitrofurantoin 100 mg TDS for 5 days, very standard dose. This is what we're going to use. For alternative drugs, you can use cotrimoxazole, that is TMP-SMX, trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole, double strength tablet, that is 960 mg, that is 800 plus 160. So that's what you're going to use for 3 days, you can give, or alternatively, you can give a phosphomycin. Phosphomycin, usually what we give is 3 gram sachet as a single dose. I'll ask the patient to drink this in empty stomach in the morning in 100 ml. Lukewarm water. Mix this sachet, 3 gram sachet, drink it once. So this is what we call single dose therapy. That's a phosphomycin for uncomplicated UTI. Single dose is more than enough. So this is the treatment for uncomplicated UTI. Remember, if somebody asks you the most superior treatment of all, I will actually go for nitrofurantoin only. Currently, this is the most superior treatment, even better than phosphomycin according to many trials. So that's why I prefer going for phosphomycin. Sorry, nitrofurantoin ahead of phosphomycin. But advantage of phosphomycin is only a single dose. That's a big advantage of phosphomycin. Clear? Male and female child investigation. Yes, there is a difference. I mean, difference. I don't know your name A1, but I mean, the current topic I'm not going to discuss on the, already we are a little bit late. So that's why I'm not running on the, I'm doing on the pediatric thing. So we have a separate session. Maybe I'll schedule a next session on a vesicular uterine reflex and pediatric urinary tract infections, where we can discuss in detail about all these things. So now you have a complicated UTI. What about the complicated UTI treatment? You are going to use fluoroquinolones, or alternatively you can use trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole also. But in these scenarios, you have to use for 7 to 14 days. In these scenarios, you have to use for 7 to 14 days. What are the fluoroquinolones you can use? Remember, all the fluoroquinolones have excellent urinary penetration. Fluoroquinolones are known for their urinary penetration. They have excellent urinary penetration. All fluoroquinolones, even in CKD patients, they have superb urinary penetration. No doubt about that. But one exception you have to know, one drug you cannot use is moxifloxacin. This moxifloxacin does not have urinary penetration at all. So whenever you consider a UTI, whenever you think about UTI, do not use moxifloxacin. This is very, again, a very important question, man. Exam. Whenever you want to divide a fluoroquinolone, you have 4 generation of fluoroquinolones. First generation, second generation, third generation and fourth generation. Even though there are a lot of different generations, these are arbitrarily I am telling. First generation is nalidixic acid. Second generation is ofloxacin, norfloxacin, ciprofloxacin. And cipro has one of the excellent urinary penetration along with norfloxacin. Third generation, we have levofloxacin and gemifloxacin. Even though levo is very commonly used in India, fourth generation we call moxifloxacin. I am talking about only the commonly used antibiotics. Don't confuse with their pharmacology aspect. So what are the commonly used antibiotics? These are the commonly used antibiotics in India. Clear? Among this, which of the following can be used for urinary tract infection? The first 3 generation all have excellent gram-negative cover and they can be used as UTI. But remember, all the 4 generations have very good gram-negative cover. All the 4 generations have very good gram-negative cover. But only first 3 generation, that is up to levofloxacin, you can use for UTI. Because I told you, moxifloxacin has poor urinary penetration. Poor urinary penetration. Alright. At the same time, your third and fourth generation have 2 additional covers. One is a gram positive cover and second one is they have very good atypical cover also. So that is the reason your third and fourth generation quinolones are often referred to as respiratory quinolones. Respiratory quinolones, which means they can be used for low respiratory tract infections like pneumonia and moderate to severe pneumonias. You can use these respiratory quinolones, and in this, the fourth generation alone, this moxifloxacin alone has a very excellent anaerobic cover. Moxifloxacin alone has an excellent anaerobic cover. So because of its excellent anaerobic cover, moxifloxacin can be used in lung abscess and aspiration also. Because in aspiration and lung abscess, anaerobic cover is really important. bottom. So that is the reason why moxifloxacin is used for anaerobic cover. And finally, the second and third generation quinolones also have a decent pseudomonal activity. And the most important fluoroquinolone that has pseudomonal cover is ciprofloxacin and levofloxacin. So these are the two antibiotics that are going to have excellent pseudomonal cover, levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin. Clear? In that, which is better? Ciprofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin has a better pseudomonal cover compared to that of the levofloxacin. And finally, you also know this third and fourth generation, all second, third and fourth generation also have anti-tubercular cover. Anti-tubercular cover, anti-TB cover is there for second, third and fourth generation. Obviously, better drugs are levofloxacin and moxifloxacin. Better, that is third and fourth are better for anti-TB cover. That is levofloxacin, moxifloxacin are better drugs for anti-tuberculosis cover. So these are the different things that you have to know about the fluoroquinolones. And fluoroquinolones itself have a lot of toxicity because these are being one of the commonly used drugs. They can produce photosensitivity. These are the side effects of fluoroquinolones, photosensitivity. And they can prolong the QT interval. You can remember Q for quinolones, Q for prolonged QT interval. They can produce tendinitis. And very commonly, they affect the Achilles tendon. And they can even result in a tendon rupture. They can be causing arthritis, especially of the large joints. They can produce neurotoxicity, like peripheral neuropathy, like picture, neurotoxicity is possible. And they are also contraindicated in children less than 18 years of age. You cannot use in children less than 18 years because the risk of arthritis and tendinitis in these people, and they can cause cartilage erosions because the growing cartilage erosion is very bad. That's why we don't use in children less than 18 years. I mean, not exactly 18 years. 8 years is the absolute contraindication. Less than 18 years is relative, and you cannot use this in pregnant women. Try to avoid in children and pregnant women. Very important again. Do not use. Avoid in this group because of this problems. Because quinolones are known to have excellent urinary penetration. Remember, there are, I don't know how to tell, very, very good urinary penetration. They achieve very high levels even in CKD patients. That's why quinolones are regarded as very high drugs in urinary tract infection. So many reasons are there why we consider this quinolones as very high level drug. So we have covered on cystitis. Now, how will you do urethritis? Urethritis, empirical cover should include both Neisseria as well as Chlamydia. There are two, isn't it? Neisseria and your Chlamydia. And empirical treatment for your urethritis should cover both Neisseria and Chlamydia. Neisseria, usually we give Cotrimoxole, TMP, SMX. Or you can give Ceftriaxone. Ceftriaxone, just 250 mg, single intramuscular dose. Plus or minus azithromycin, 1 gram, single dose, stat dose. Both are stat doses. IM stat doses, or you can give 1 gram azithromycin, with or without 1 gram azithromycin stat dose. This is the treatment for Neisseria. For Chlamydia, you are going to obviously use doxycycline. Doxycycline is the treatment of choice for Chlamydia. Atypical cover, 100 mg BD for 7 days, or you can give alternatively azithromycin, 1 gram stat dose. Oral dose. Clear? That's all. Remember, but what we prefer is doxycycline. Doxycycline has superior efficacy for Chlamydia compared to that of azithromycin. Remember, azithromycin is used preferred only in case of a pregnant woman, where doxycycline cannot be used. So only pregnant, because it causes teeth staining of the fetus. So that is the reason why we don't use doxycycline in pregnant women. Apart from that, they can be used in other areas, non-pregnant women population. Clear? So, but whenever in doubt, give combination of both. So, if you are giving empirical treatment and you cannot confirm the diagnosis, give both. And you have a third organism, you know, Mycoplasma genitalium. So, how will you treat a Mycoplasma genitalium? Again, azithromycin, 1 gram stat dose. That's all. Single dose is enough to treat a urethritis due to Mycoplasma. But anyway, so whenever you want to give an empirical cover, you give Ceftriaxone plus either a doxy or a azithromycin. Anyone you can give. So this is how you give a empirical treatment. Clear? But in general, azithromycin is one drug. You can see that covers all, you know, like organisms. So in general, azithromycin is going to cover all the organisms. You can see very clearly, but even the azithromycin is inferior. Please do understand, azithromycin is not superior except for mycoplasma. Even for Neisseria, azithromycin alone is inferior. Even for chlamydia, azithromycin is inferior compared to doxy. So as an empirical option, if they ask you which drug covers all the three organisms that causes urethritis, answer will be azithromycin. This is the only drug that covers uniformly all the three organisms. And suppose if the patient is having a catheter, catheterized patients, what you have to do? You can use antibiotics plus you can remove catheter. We are talking about a CAUTI, catheter-associated urinary tract infection. So give antibiotics like how you treat a urine usual UTI, plus at the same time remove the catheter. Very important. Suppose if catheter is there, but no UTI, which means this patient is having a sterile pyuria. That is because of the foreign body. That is a catheter being like a foreign body, it's going to act like a foreign body causing a sterile pyuria. In this condition, no antibiotics are recommended. No antibiotics are recommended. At the same time, you can continue catheterization. Continue cath, there is no problem at all. Because it's a foreign body related sterile pyuria, patient is not having a UTI, only pus cells are seen in the urine. This is not an indication to remove the catheter. And there is no need of antibiotics in this scenario. You can just continue with the catheter. Clear? So no problem. So then how will you treat a prostatitis? Prostatitis, you need a longer treatment because prostatic penetration of antibiotics is a little bit poor. So that is the reason you need a little bit of longer course of antibiotics. For example, you can use a fluoroquinolone or you can use a trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole. That is cotrimoxazole, double strength tablet for 2 to 4 weeks. Which means you need a longer course of treatment. This is very important. Longer course of treatment because the penetration will be poor. So this is for acute prostatitis. Support is, if it's a chronic prostatitis, you need an even more longer course. I can write here. So this is for acute prostatitis. Or you might be even needing for 6 to 12 weeks of therapy if it's a chronic prostatitis. So even more longer treatment for a chronic prostatitis. So these are all some of the important points, and this again has been a very common question in exam. How long you will give antibiotics in case of prostatitis? Because you cannot stop the antibiotics within 1 to 2 weeks. The examiner wants to know that fact from you. So that is the reason why they ask these kind of questions. These are very practical things. And pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis, if they are not sick. Which means they are only having fever, not so sick, not septic, BP is normal, pulse rate is normal. You can just treat as an OP basis, outpatient basis, where you can give simple fluoroquinolones for 7 days, or you can treat with a cotrimoxazole, TMP-SMX for 14 days. So these are the options. So how long will it take for catheter-associated urinary tract infection? Depends on the organism. In general, again, catheter-associated urinary tract infection will be treated as the same way like how I treated a cystitis. How I'm going to treat a cystitis, in the same way I'll be treating catheter-associated urinary tract infection also. So which means I can tell antibiotics that are similar to cystitis treatment. That's all. So pyelonephritis, if they're not sick, this is the usual treatment. If they're sick, if they're having a borderline BP, maybe 90-60, pulse rate is high, patient is looking a little sick, septic, not so well, not so feeling well, admit them, treat as inpatient, where you can use ceftriaxone. Depending on what type of Foleys you are going to use, how long can we keep Foleys minimum? So depends on what type of Foleys, your usual, like the latex type of Foleys that you are using can be kept in situ for 7 to 14 days. That's the maximum. Usually I generally remove within 7 to 10 days. But even though the tubing backside, if you see, they themselves still up to 14 days, you can keep this in a well-maintained Foleys, you can keep up to 7 to 14 days. But if you want to keep for a longer run, you prefer a silicone tube. You have something called a silicone catheters are available, so which can be actually kept in situ for almost 4 weeks. So prefer a silicone tube, silicone type of catheters, if you want to have a longer duration of this thing. At the same time, next thing is, like, if you really want a very, very long time and the patient is having severe obstruction, then go for a SPC. So that is better comparatively. But anyway, so Foleys means 7 to 14 days. If you want a longer duration, go for silicone catheters. Clear? That's the idea. So sick means you can prefer a ceftriaxone, or you can do a ampicillin sulbactam, or even you can prefer aminoglycoside also. Typically we give for inpatient, the duration of these antibiotics are 14 days, because pyelonephritis means itself is complicated, especially inpatient. If they are sick means you have to give for a longer duration. Ceftriaxone, ampicillin sulbactam or aminoglycoside, this is what the antibiotics we prefer. Clear? Suppose, remember, whenever you give antibiotics, ideally speaking, fever should resolve. Fever resolves within 72 hours, 40 to 72 hours. Clear? Fever resolves within 40 to 72 hours. In this condition, you can shift to oral drugs. There is no need to continue with IV drugs. Shift to oral drugs. If there is no resolution of fever within 40 to 72 hours, I told you, suspect a renal abscess. Suspect renal abscess and do a CT scan immediately. So this is very, very important. Suspect renal abscess and give CT scan. If renal abscess is there, you have to aspirate the abscess. Otherwise, your fever is not going to resolve. A lot of alternative antibiotics are there. Depending on the culture, what are the alternate antibiotics for IP patients? You can give culture based. For example, you can use piperacillin tazobactam. You can use carbapenems like meropenem, imipenem and all. So it all depends on what is the sensitivity pattern. Carbapenems, all these things you can use. And again, you can give according to the culture sensitivity.
This is for acute. Clear?
So this is what you're going to do. So then finally, you're going to have renal abscess. Renal abscess. So renal abscess, you have to do drainage. I told you already. Whenever you do a renal abscess, first thing is drainage plus antibiotics. What antibiotics you are going to give? Antibiotics that you are going to give should be tailored according to how you are going to give for a pyelonephritis. That's all. Antibiotic regimens will be similar to that of pyelonephritis. That's all. So this is how you are going to give antibiotics. Very, very simple. Clear? So that's it. So this is how you give antibiotics. So this is how you treat a renal abscess. So any other doubts you want to ask? So I think I've covered extensively on how to treat a urinary tract infection. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. I'll give you 2 to 3 minutes. Okay, if you don't have any other doubts, I'll finish off with the summary now. Summary: UTI is a spectrum. Urinary tract infection, it could be upper or it could be lower, or it could be complicated or it could be uncomplicated. So a lot of these things are there. So it's a big spectrum of infection, UTI itself. So, ideally remember, whenever there is a lower UTI, like cystitis or urethritis, cystitis may not have a fever. Usually patients will be afebrile, only they will have urinary symptoms. Urethritis will have an associated urethral discharge. And remember, whenever you have urethritis, it is likely to be a sexually transmitted infection. It is not like a simple urinary tract infection. Whenever you have an upper UTI, which means it's a could be a pyelonephritis, or it could be a renal abscess, or it could be a prostatitis. So these are the areas. Remember, in this, one important thing about prostatitis is they will have obstructive symptoms. Most often, prostatitis will have obstructive symptoms. At the same time, you need long course of treatment. Long treatment for prostatitis, especially for chronic prostatitis, where you might be needing treatment for 4 to 6 weeks. And pyelonephritis and renal abscess, patients will be usually sick and they will have fever, and they'll present like a systemic illness, which means like a focus of infection. That's how they present with. So this is usual feature of a pyelonephritis and a renal abscess. So whenever you start antibiotics and if it's not responding, think about a renal abscess. Antibiotics, no response within 40 to 70 hours for a pyelonephritis, think about renal abscess and do a CT and diagnose a renal abscess. And finally, antibiotic regimens, we have seen different groups need different antibiotic regimes. Cystitis has to be treated differently. Urethritis has to be treated differently. And prostatitis has to be treated differently. And finally, your pyelonephritis and renal abscess also has to be treated differently. Clear? So these are the final summary I want to say. So whenever you think about an organism, always think about E. coli. E. coli is the most common organism in any type of urinary tract infection. Apart from that, you have enterococcus, you can get with Pseudomonas aeruginosa, you can get even Staphylococcus epidermidis. So many organisms are there. So all these things can also produce urinary tract infection. So right now, so these are the summary of UTI. So there are a lot more things are there. I cannot teach the entire infectious disease in this particular session. It's, you know, like a very short session so that I have to be a little bit crisp. So that's why I've told you only the approach to UTI and how to diagnose a urinary tract infection according to the current concept. So right now, we'll close the session and thank you all and thank you very, very much.